All the faculty come
share with you. Do you have the page of the last class? Do you have the page?
No.
Okay, so let's read about Hickman Corporation. So, what does penetrate mean? Another way to say penetrate in English.
Pierce.
Going to, right? They want to go into the US market. Do you know Hickman? Have you heard of Hickman before?
Yeah.
Right, so the life cycle of a company, right? The life cycle we should know, seen before. Okay, the start of the company is usually the high, get off the ground as hard, and then we have some high growth stage, then there's the plateau, and then slowly going down, right? So they might use, it says here, it can influence the marketing, the life cycle. So where we are in the life cycle. So let's read the next part. So, yeah.
After World War II, product U.S. military troops, government advisors, and businessmen stationed in post-war Japan had acquired a taste for Japanese food, particularly soy sauce, in 1957. Hickman established a working subsidiary in San Francisco and gradually expanded the number and the locations of U.S. sales office. Los Angeles
offices.
Eh?
Offices.
Offices. Los Angeles, New York City, Chicago, Atlanta, and Dallas. Hickman initially imported all this soy sauce for the U.S. market from Japan, but as demand grew, it looked for ways to cut shipping costs. In 1967, Hickman entered into a co-packing arrangement with a sauce producer in Oakland, California. Bulk soy sauce was transported from Japan in metal tanks to the salt plant in San Francisco Bay, where it was packaged for distribution.
Okay, do you have any question here about the vocabulary? Okay, let's read the last part. Yang Sung Wan. Someone here. Jae Tae Min. Not here. Kim Sang Kim.
In 1970, Cisco Man started planning and manufacturing in the United States because Cisco Man was already purchasing all the soybean and wheat supplies for soy sauce production from U.S. producers. Elimination of transportation costs and time lags was desirable. The company located the plant in Burwood, Wisconsin, due to its proximity to agriculture supplies. Originally estimated to be profitable within 5 years, the U.S. operations became profitable within 3.5 years. In 1998, the company opened a second U.S. plant in Folsom, California, significantly expanding its capacity. By 2002, approximately 80% of Cisco Man's soy sauce sold internationally was manufactured in the United States, where it continues to dominate both the soy and teriyaki sauce categories.
Okay, so just here we can see the story of the Cisco Man, starting like just a traditional company. They start off with exporting, they have low demand. Then maybe they make contracts. They made a contract next with a salt producer. Okay. Then after that, they moved on to the FDI, okay, the highest risk or the highest commitment. And they built the factory or manufacturing plant in the US. Okay. And then in the end, they actually, nowadays, they do most of their manufacturing in the US because their raw materials like soybean and wheat supplies is being bought in the US. So we can see that the company can change their market entry strategy over time as they grow. Okay, do you have any question about this example? No, well then let's move on to the L'Oreal case. So, first of all, what kind of industry is L'Oreal in?
Cosmetics.
Cosmetics. And wider industry is called consumer packaged goods, or CPG. Is consumer. This kind of industry people buy a product and they use it, and then they need to buy another product very quickly. Okay. So, for example, toothpaste, deodorant, laundries, okay, shampoo, so on. So people use every day. They use this product almost every day, and they need to buy very often. That's kind of an industry. So, when we talked about the industry before, do you think that there is a high competition or low competition in this kind of industry?
High competition,
right? So, there's high competition. Can people easily change from one? Is there a high switching barrier or low switching barrier? Is it easy or not easy for people to switch?
Easy.
It's easy. So there's a lot of switching barriers. Okay. So most companies, big companies in this area, they have to do very aggressive marketing and a lot of innovation. So first of all, we need to understand what kind of industry it is. Okay. So we need constant innovation and aggressive marketing because it's very competitive, and there's a lot of price pressure and a lot of companies competing. So we're going to look at the case of L'Oreal. So L'Oreal is giving a high performance product, and it is trying to do localization too, right? So it's trying to give the global brand name, okay, and high quality product, but also to localize the product to the consumer's taste. So we're going to go through the case. This is more of an evaluated rather than problem case. We'll follow the case study here. Okay. And you'll need to complete this page and hand it in to me, right? That's 10% of your grade. Okay. So I think it's better as we go. You can write down the important information here in the qualitative data or quantitative data. Okay. So we're going to look at three main questions. What is L'Oreal doing? How are they doing that? And what are the trade-offs? Okay. So we're going to look at what is L'Oreal doing? So how are they doing that? And what is the trade-off? So the trade-off means that although we do something, we may lose something else. Okay? We do one thing, like for example, we decide to localize, then that means we could be losing something else, like for example, the economies of scale. Right? That's a trade-off. So first of all, I asked you guys, I gave you a part of the case to read. So what we're going to do is to go through the case today. We should finish more or less in this class. And just write down, go through the case together. Right? If you want, you can open the case on your computer. Okay. But you can follow the reading, right? Or if you have printed it out. Okay. Otherwise, you just follow on the board. Let's start with the introduction here. So, which students were reading the introduction? So just put up your hand. There was two or three students reading the introduction. So what can you tell me about this part?
Yes.
So tell us about what did you, what's the main point?
This paragraph is a general introduction about what is L'Oreal company.
Yes.
And L'Oreal core strategy is launching new innovative products on a regular basis.
Oh, new innovative products?
Yes.
Regularly? Want to have new innovative products constantly or regularly, you need a good R&D.
Yes. And how many lawyers, employers and grand factories are all over the world?
Yes, so how many countries is it in?
130
countries?
Yes.
How many brands does it have, global brands?
23
global brands.
Yes.
Oh, it's a big company. Okay.
Yes.
So it says here, it mentions, how does it sell its cosmetics? Where does it sell its cosmetics? At the end. Sells in department stores. Retail. Just normal retail. You have duty free. internet, and professionals, self-directed to professionals. What professionals do you think L'Oreal sells to? What kind of professionals does L'Oreal sell to? What professionals is L'Oreal selling there?
Makeup artists.
Yes. Hair stylists. Fashion. People working in the fashion industry. Okay. So then, selling the science of beauty around the world, also related to the introduction, like the history. So who read that part? Can you tell us about what's the main point?
L'Oreal started with an innovation, but its international reach was interrupted by the perception of Parisian beauty product as being expensive and out of reach.
So it has a problem. It had a problem that was too expensive, right, for ordinary people. So,
the upcoming CEO focused on five core businesses and technologies to be a global company. After L'Oreal acquiring many companies around the world, L'Oreal started to be the leading company globally.
Okay, so what five core businesses did they focus on?
Hair color, hair care, skin care, color, cosmetics, and fragrances.
So they have mainly five businesses, right? Hair color,
hair care,
hair care.
Skin care,
color cosmetics, like makeup, right? And fragrance, perfume. So, anything else here?
L'Oreal acquired many companies.
L'Oreal acquired companies?
Yes.
Why?
Perception of...
Okay, so it acquired companies in where? In the US, in China, and India. So this is helping them to make local more localized, right? They look at the example of Maybelline. They had the problem they were too expensive for ordinary people, L'Oreal, right? So when they acquired, in the US they acquired Maybelline. Do you know Maybelline? Okay. Then this is going to be high quality, low price, right? Acquiring companies help them in this with this problem, and also with local, getting more local. So then the organization, how is it? How is L'Oreal organized? So who wrote this part? Who read this part? You did? What can you tell us about the organization?
It was organized into three divisions. And then they had a joint venture with Nestle. They put 20% the cosmetics generated more than 93% of the company's revenue. then they also broke down the operations into four divisions, which was consumer product division, luxury products division, the professional products division, active cosmetics department.
So they have four divisions: consumer product, luxury products, professional products, active cosmetics. So are these, are all these divisions linked or not linked? Are they linked together or kept separate?
They're kept separate. They're marketed in different segments.
Why?
I think it's to make sure that the, each brand or each division is structured in a way that they don't fail in a certain particular field.
They don't what?
They don't fail. Like they market them in an aggressive way.
Okay, so the point is they have different customers, right? So all divisions have different customers. So they're like in different boxes. And they don't, they're just separate, completely separate. Okay, we don't want to mix up our luxury product with our consumer products. Okay? Is people going to buy our luxury product if it's mixed up with the consumer product? No, right? So they don't, each one has their own innovation, their own R&D. Okay? Let's split up. So they can't change, they don't change the position of the brand. If your brand is here, it stays here, it doesn't change. Okay, if your brand is here, it stays here, it doesn't change. Okay? So then the next part, the local consumer understanding.
Adapt in each continent.
Okay, so that it has to adapt to the local test.
Yeah.
So they used to do, other companies used to do just a global strategy, the same product for every country. Okay, but nowadays that's finished, right? They need to make a local strategy. So how do they do that?
They created geocosmetics.
Okay, what is geocosmetics?
They had the different research centers in each part of the world.
So we have a research center in different areas of the world, right?
Yeah.
So for example,
Chicago in 2005. Then Pudong, China, after that Japan.
So instead of having, sometimes often companies can have R&D in just global R&D, right? Research and development center just in one country. But L'Oreal has all the research, even research and development is local. So why? Why don't they just get all of their top people to go to Chicago or just one city and do all the research of development together. Research and development is usually centralized, so why does L'Oréal do in the local research and development in each country?
Because people are different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's like, for example, people's skin is different in Asia than in America, right? So they have to do a different type of research and development. Usually you have different, better skin in Asia, right? Do I look very old? How old do you think I am? Do I look very old? Okay, A plus. You're supposed to say 25, and it would have been even better. But it's bad luck for my wife, right? After 10 years, I'm going to look like old Western guy, maybe bald, put on some weight, and bad skin, right? But Korean hair and skin is different, or Chinese hair and skin is different. Okay, so that's why they have a research center in China, because it's specific about Chinese skin and hair. Okay, so for example, in China, they developed 300 products specifically for Chinese customers. This helped them. Also, they made the product in India, they can sell in the rest of Asia, right? They have different R&D, different innovation. So then, anything else here on the local consumer understanding?
No.
Okay. So, let's move on to brand diversity. Do you understand diversity?
Yeah.
What does diversity mean? What does diverse mean?
Different.
Different, right? So who read the brand diversity? Okay, what can you tell us here?
L'Oréal diversifies their brands, especially their distribute their product channels according to customers' income, like low, mid, and high end. They cover all the ranges of customers. There are examples for each section of the range. For high end, Lancome and Yves Saint Laurent, which sell in department store only, to give them premium image. For mid, from mid to high, premium actually, mastige. And for low-end brand, Garnier. They deal with broad customers.
Oh, just a second. So the mid-end brand, what's the an example of a mid brand?
Mastige. Excellent. Yeah.
Mastige is the name of this Mastige, but what's the name of the product? Example, does it say an example of a product here?
No, they don't.
L'Oréal Paris.
Paris?
Yes. And the low end one, where do they sell the L'Oréal Paris?
L'Oréal Paris.
Maybe in department store and retail, right? What about the low end brand?
Low end brand is Garnier.
Garnier?
Yep.
Okay. So what does Mastige mean?
Mastige means prestige for the masses.
Do you understand prestige?
Yeah.
What does prestige mean?
Premium
or good, like high quality, right? And then mass is a lot of people. So they want to make this kind of mid-level brand. They don't want to be just up here because they don't have enough customers, right? At the high level. So they want to make a kind of prestige, but that's most people can't afford. So they call this mastige. So they have the different option. Okay, we have this product for the high income, this product for the middle income, and this product for the lower income people. Okay, do we mix the brands? No, we don't, right? People might not know. If you know Yves Saint Laurent, do you know that that's L'Oréal?
No.
Does it say L'Oreal on the box?
No.
Does it say L'Oreal on the advertisement? No, so they're different. Different brands. Okay? Other examples of products here for L'Oreal? Here in Garnier, you can even sell in the kiosk. Says here, even sells in kiosks. Kiosk is like some, can even be on the street, something on the street in some countries, right? But you wouldn't do that for the other brands. So this one in India. In India, they can sell on the street, right? That's kind of local marketing. So this is retail in the other areas, just in the retail outlet. Anything else here? What's L'Oreal's best known premium brand?
Lancome.
Lancome. Okay. Do you know Lancome?
No.
Do you buy Lancome?
No.
Well, they spend a lot of money on the R&D. Okay, so we're going to start the rating because we have to continue, right? So you should be making a note of what you think is the important information about. I already told you the problem. You can write in the problem. This is an evaluation case. So in the problem box, you can write, what is L'Oreal doing and how are they doing that, right? And what are the trade-off? What is the trade-off? So three things to put in the problem box, right? What is L'Oreal doing? So right here, what is L'Oreal doing? Okay, how is it doing it? So write in this box here. If you don't have this page, then write on another piece of paper. Problem, okay, what is L'Oreal doing? How is it doing it? And what is the trade-off? Okay, that's the problem. Then you should be writing in the most important data here. If you don't have enough space, you can continue down into this box or write on a new page, okay? But what's the important data here for what L'Oreal is doing and how they are doing it, okay? So as we're doing this on the board, you have to think, is that important data? And write it in here. Okay, do you understand? Anyway, we have a video of the class. You can watch the video later. It's showing all over the board. Maybe it's marketing. Maybe it's marketing. You did. So what can you tell us about this part? About their marketing?
L'Oreal has become known for its ability to acquire brands and make over, shift their image and roll them down globally. Especially with Maybelline.
So they're very good at shifting the image, right? Of brands. So they buy a brand and they can move up the image. Change the image of the brand, okay? So can you give us the example, what was the example of Maybelline? How did they change Maybelline's brand image?
Well, at that time Maybelline had lost focus, was really brand big. Through L'Oreal's overhaul of Maybelline's operations, and brand and advertising and word modernizing, Maybelline has become L'Oreal's passport to the conquest of new emerging markets.
Okay, so they just changed their operations, brand, and advertising. organize this. So they modernized. How did they modernize it, for example? Gives a couple of examples about how they modernized the Maybelline brand. Who else was reading about maybe it's Maybelline? There should have been two or three students reading this part.
They invested a lot for advertising, and they made a very modernized advertisement, Mommy Chill. Mommy Chill.
What's Mommy Chill?
Mommy Chill is an advertisement. It totally changed the consumer's image for Maybelline, this brand.
Okay, so we had a Miami Chill, which was, they used Christy Turlington, right?
Yep.
Who was a young and fashionable actress, okay? So it was fun and fashion. They give the idea of fun and fashion. Is Miami fun?
Yeah.
Right, people go to Miami for parties and so on, right? And they used the actress Christy Turlington. Do you know Christy Turlington?
Yeah.
What movie was she in? I'm not that familiar with the actresses. Was she in the Mad Max? The truck driver in Mad Max? Was that Christy Turlington? No? Who was that?
Charlize.
I'm not that up with the actresses, but you guys might know, right? Well, anyway, she was like young and chic, means fashionable actress. Okay. So they changed the image of Maybelline. And the sales grew very quickly. Okay. Maybelline was L'Oreal's main brand in the new emerging markets. Okay. Their tagline of Maybelline is maybe she's born with it, maybe it's Maybelline. So they're trying to say that it's not that the woman is naturally beauty. They're saying maybe it's Maybelline, right? Maybe it's because of the makeup and those things. Right? That was their marketing. So then the next one is the regionally focused rollout. Somebody comes to their house and demonstrates the product, and then they buy the product, yes?
But L'Oreal didn't follow the trend.
Yes.
They said the L'Oreal's is targeting is they create the retail, they create the retail system, and
okay.
They sell their products to the like hairdressers and hair salon managers, and maybe they can sell their products to the consumers, so they can make their products for babies.
they didn't try to compete directly with the Brazilian companies on the door-to-door sales, right?
Yes.
They tried a different strategy, maybe a little bit risky. They tried to sell through retail and hair care managers.
They also said that when the market's competition is growing up, the door-to-door system is getting weaker.
Okay, so they thought this is going to be weak, the trend is weaker. And they don't have the understanding, right? The Brazilian companies have a better understanding, which is always hard for the global company, right, to compete, but the Brazilian company's understanding is better. So they tried a different one. Then anything else here?
That's all I got.
Okay, so they have the hair care managers and the saloons also worked well for them, right? They marketed directly to the hair care manager in the saloon. And this, they gave training session for hairdressers. Training sessions. They offer free training. So, they have an internet and magazine and word of mouth advertising, right? So they have to be a little bit creative, because in Latin America, maybe this kind of word of mouth is important, right? Do you understand word of mouth?
Yes.
So the friend recommends the, you know, somebody comes to your house and recommends the product, then they buy, right? Or the hairdresser recommends the product. So L'Oreal tried to get in contact with the hair care professionals by offering like free training sessions and maybe free samples and products, and then they can recommend to their customers. Okay? I think Brazil is a country that spends a lot of money on beauty products. People in Brazil spend a lot of money on beauty products, so they're not going to just see the advertisement on TV and say, oh, I'm going to buy that, right? They're interested in that kind of thing, so they read the magazine, they talk to the hair care professional, they talk to their friends, okay? So it's a different challenge to sell it in that kind of country. But it's an example, right? They make a different strategy for every region, different type of strategy for every country, depending on the country. So then telling the story. Have you read this part, telling the story? And so what is the main point here?
Laura says the world has changed from with no options to infinite options. So they need to care about diverse customer base like Asian population or ethnic groups, aspiring customers in the East. Emerging market, health and beauty care, industry for men.
So trends, you have to think about trends in the, a lot of people are aging, right? That's a big opportunity for this, you know, the anti-aging products. The emerging markets, the, for example, China especially, right?
Yeah.
People's income is growing. And men. More men are interested in that product. Okay. So?
So they started to put more money on advertisement.
Okay. So they spend 4.5 billion every year on advertising. Because they have these opportunities. and this kind of industry is very competitive, right? So we talked about before they do aggressive advertising. Aggressive, one way of being aggressive is spending a lot of money. Anything else?
Especially they decided to spend more money on the online marketing.
Online marketing?
Yes, like blog or SNS.
So they're starting to do more less traditional, I'd say less traditional advertising. Is increasing. Okay. But where is most of its advertising going? Where does it spend most of its advertising money? Spends most of its money on TV, right? Around 70% of its budget is on TV ads. Okay, so that, obviously that's changing these days. We'll talk about more later in the last class, but the online marketing, right? So again, it's aggressively spending a lot of money in China for the advertising in order to get more of the market there. So, the next part is fame by association. So who read this part? Yes, what are the main points here?
So they are often the A-list celebrity and stars in highly successful ad campaigns to push products to a wide range of age brackets, ethnicity, and gender. Lauriers was also a major sponsor of the Cannes Film Festival and prepared the actor and actress with Lauriers makeup before they walked the red carpet.
Okay, so just a second. So for the celebrities, they chose Sarah Jessica Parker for Garnier.
Yeah.
They like Christy Turner. They like the fun, lively image for the younger adults. Okay, that's for the younger who don't have as much money, maybe. Okay, you understand lively image. Do you know Sarah Jessica Parker? Do you know Sex and the City? The TV show from the US,
yeah.
10 years ago? The blonde haired woman. Okay. Okay, then you said that they also sponsor some film show, right? So they sponsor the film show and the act give the and they give the makeup to the actresses. So the actresses use the L'Oreal makeup on the red carpet. Okay, anything else?
Also sponsors the festival dinner and after party.
Okay. So we can see some other names here: Julia Roberts, Jennifer Aniston, okay, Cheryl Cole, Penelope Cruz, okay, Pierce Brosnan is men. Okay. So they use all ages, races, and sexes for the A-list celebrity. Different ages, different race, and so on. Okay, they don't just focus on like Barbie. So then I think that's all we have time for today. We'll just finish the going through the case in the next class. We just have one or two sections left, right? Then we can discuss about the questions that we talked about, okay? if you think about those questions. What is L'Oréal doing and how is it doing it? What are trade-offs? Okay. So do you have any questions then? About